So, before we get started, I'd like to disclaim that I'm not a doctor on mental health, and that the following information is based on various resources online and my own personal experience. Mental illness and mental disorders are a tough subject to tackle whilst being both honest yet not condemning of the person who has it. They're often a go-to for explaining the actions of characters who are violent and unstable. Serial killers, for example, are often portrayed as having schizophrenia, or even something like autism, like what a lot of old slasher films did. Then there's your flavor-of-the-month serial killer illnesses like dissociative identity disorder and obsessive-compulsive disorder. They're the kind of disorder you'd see used as a gimmick to spice up the tried-and-true vision we have of serial killers.
This week on Special Murder-Catching Team Duo, a serial killer with Tourette's?
Wow, that's extra crazy. I better watch that.
When used as a recurring trope, these depictions of mental illness and disorders can set up expectations within our subconscious that these people are always dangerous, even if at the start we openly recognize it's just fiction. But if these fictional depictions we have of mental illnesses and disorders are the only time we see those people deal with it, we often become conditioned to that depiction rather than understanding the reality of it. I'm sure this is not the goal of content creators, and I sympathize with wanting to execute your story the way you want to, but you have to consider how what you're portraying may affect other people. Having a mental illness or disorder doesn't mean you're a huge safety hazard just by being alive. It may stop you from having certain jobs, and in some cases I'm sure that's fair. But when it comes to day-to-day living, a person suffering from a mental illness or disorder is no more of a hazard than anyone else. Admittingly, antisocial personality disorder is quite trickier to manage. People with APD lack a certain level of empathy that is commonly needed to form deep bonds with others and to understand and care how a person is feeling. Having APD doesn't doom you to a life of crime, please keep that in mind. But growing up traumatized or in a bad environment does leave you more susceptible to developing criminal behavior. Sometimes in the media, characters with mental illnesses and disorders aren't portrayed as being cruel or dangerous, especially as of late. An example of a character with dissociative identity disorder is Jessica Buchanan from One Life to Live. Yeah, I've watched soap operas since I was a kid, don't judge me. Jessica has three alternate personalities known as Tess, Bess, and Wes, which can be basically summed up as the flirty bad girl, the smart responsible one, and the punky boy. I don't remember any of her personalities being anything more than mischievous, which is no different from literally every other character on the show. While she may struggle with them, they aren't inherently violent, because she as a person isn't violent, and they are all just fractions of her whole being. How accurate is it to real DID? I couldn't tell you, but it's more realistic than a person with 30 personalities who all for some reason want to commit murder. An example of a character with obsessive-compulsive disorder is Adrian Monk. To quote the Monk Wiki, Monk is described as being a modern-day Sherlock Holmes, only nuts. Some people may feel that's rather insensitive, but let me tell you in a moment why someone like me, who does suffer from OCD, doesn't really take statements like that too personally. I don't think I've ever explained to you guys my problems with OCD. Let me tell you a little bit about what it was like for me. OCD is an incurable condition where you feel you have to repeat certain behaviors over and over again to soothe your anxiety. Your mind nags at you until you have fulfilled your compulsion. It's an itch you must scratch. Constantly checking something, hoarding, obsessive cleaning, intrusive thoughts, all forms of OCD. I struggle with obsessive cleaning and intrusive thoughts. For the most part, my obsessive cleaning has been managed, thank God. Not cured, but managed. When I was younger, it was awful. I recall it starting around first or second grade. I didn't like people touching me, especially if I hadn't been very carefully watching, like a creeper, where their hands had been. If I didn't think you washed after using the toilet, there was no way we were going to share the same toys. It then progressed to the point where I'd even wash my paper assignments that were handed out in class. How in the fuck do you wash papers, you may ask? Well, Timmy, let me tell you how you fucking wash paper. First, clean the desk you're going to use to rest the paper on. Then, you get a paper towel, rinse it in soap and water, squeeze as much water out of it as possible, and gently stroke that piece of paper on your clean desk. Then, you flip it over onto another part of the desk that wasn't just touching the dirty side of the paper, and clean that side of the paper, and then clean the desk where the dirty side of the paper had been touching. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't make sense. There is no harmful dirt or germs on that piece of paper, and cleaning things that it had just been touching is insane! But in my sick little head, it made sense. It made me feel better. It made me feel in control of something. Cleaning was a sacred task, a ritual in which you had to go through specific steps to properly clean an item, or you'd have to start all over. It took up way too much of my time and effort, and made the other kids think I was weird. I mean, they weren't wrong, I was weird, but kids are a bit less forgiving about that stuff, and it was hard to sustain friendships and have people take me seriously until I was a lot older. Around fifth grade, my mother took me to a child psychologist. A diagnosis for OCD was confirmed alongside with ADHD. Dealing with my disorder caused me a lot of anxiety, but what also caused me a lot of anxiety was the thought of getting better. I was so afraid that I would get better for a short period of time, then relapse, and then knowing that I had tainted all of my toys and possessions while I was better, I would have to destroy everything I owned because it was now dirty to me. I knew I couldn't keep it up for long. It exhausted me, and it exhausted the people around me. When they started prepping us for middle and high school during fifth grade, they made us switch classrooms, which also meant switching desks. I was to sit in someone else's desk? Every day? Twice a day? I resisted at first, insisting that I could keep my rituals intact and continue having class with everyone else. But I couldn't. I broke down crying. I sat there cleaning my new desk and all of my possessions in it, including my stupid papers. Everyone else just watched me in silence. It was thoroughly embarrassing. After that, I just ran out of steam and that's when I began quitting my more severe habits. I still wash my hands more than what is considered normal, and when I'm under a lot of stress, I sometimes relapse and lose control, becoming irritated and more anxious about keeping clean. But I can function. And I'm so glad not to be in that place in my head anymore. Adrian Monk, although fictional, is a lot like how I was as a child, albeit more extreme and hammed up so the audience stays interested. What I like about his character is that he's not a bad man, but he sure as hell isn't perfect. He's very selfish, and that's true to real life. Having OCD often means that you're going to put your compulsions above everything else, including the needs and sensitivities of other people. It's selfish. I was selfish. Sometimes in our attempt to be accepting and understanding, we'll coddle people with disorders when it isn't appropriate to. Of course, I am thankful for having people in my life who were patient with me, but if no one ever pushed me, if no one ever made me feel uncomfortable, I may still be in that hell today. I don't mind that people make jokes about OCD or point out that it's nuts, because it is kinda nuts. But hey, being kind of nuts doesn't mean you're a bad person. Though you know what I don't think is okay? When someone writing a blog to who knows how many impressionable readers says something like, OCD will lead you to be a murderer. Care to say that again, bitch boy? Greg? Honestly, they're probably joking, but I'm not entirely sure. And if you can't convey that you're joking, it's best not to make statements like that. So what does this mean for creating a character with a mental illness or disorder? Here's my tips for you. Don't give them a mental illness or disorder just for the gimmick of it. They should be a character that develops and changes just like all the other characters, with time and effort put into researching their condition and portraying life through their eyes how they are most likely to see it. Be truthful about their disorder. Sometimes a disorder gives you a unique view of the world that aids you in succeeding in certain areas of your life, like how people with certain forms of autism tend to focus on one subject in their life and get really good at it. But it isn't all sunshine and rainbows. Most disorders are just disorders. They're draining and depressing to the person dealing with it. Don't glorify the disorder. Don't condemn it. Just be real about it. Think about what people will come away with after seeing how you portrayed that disorder. Earlier, I explained that we often portray people with mental illnesses as being scary and dangerous. For example, roles for characters with dissociative identity disorder are usually reserved for serial killers and other dangerous people. Having the freedom to write your story as you see fit is important, but please at least consider what has already been portrayed of those people before. I know it's just fiction, but fiction can tamper with our perception of reality if we're never given the chance to see people that have that condition or a character that realistically deals with that condition. When you hear that someone has schizophrenia, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Probably not John Nash, Nobel Prize winner, right? Someone more like Norman Bates is probably who you'll first think of. It's not like there aren't negatives to that condition, and some criminals have been schizophrenic. But we rarely ever recognize that people with schizophrenia can, in fact, lead lives not much different from anyone else. This is why proper diagnosis and treatment is important. If you decide you want to create a criminal character with a mental illness or disorder, consider having another character within that story that shares their condition who doesn't display criminal behavior. Just recognizing that there are kind people with that disorder can remind your audience that criminal behavior is usually due to circumstances surrounding their disorder, not the disorder itself. Do you have a mental illness or disorder? How do you feel about characters that portray that condition, and how do you feel that portrayal affects how people see you? I hope you all enjoyed this episode. If by any chance you guys are interested in doing a Q&A with me to go into detail about my OCD, please send me an ask to the OCCOJ Tumblr, which you'll find a link to in the description. If it looks like there are a lot of people who'd like that, I may host a live stream on it or make a detailed video about my experience. Thank you all for watching. We can't wait to see you next time. Bye!